We have a city which is polycentric, a lot concentric, everything goes around that, which is the city of Lisbon, which is a really powerful story and imaginarium. But the city of Lisbon only represents 1/5 of the entire population that lives in a metropolitan area.
Gentrification means a social polarization of the city, and it means a more urban class struggle deepening, you know. So to prevent that, we have to have a very strong intervention by the state.
But you also face the questions of migrants that came on the 70s and 80s, most of them from suburbs of the area of Lisboa, that are not actually in the city, always working in the city, mainly women from 6 to 9 o'clock. Then they go away, and then they come back from 6 to 9 o'clock in the evening. So they were, we say, invisible to the city. And this is the question that the gentrification of Lisboa, I believe in 1 year, most of the migrants are outside or really live in very damaged conditions. Yeah.
Por um lado, o tema da interseccionalidade, e isto enquanto feministas é-nos muito caro e muito fundamental como instrumento de pensar e agir cidade. Por outro lado, as políticas não podem ser políticas pensadas na grande escala, pensadas na homogeneização e pensadas de cima para baixo. As políticas têm de ser emanações, resultados desta interseccionalidade.
We have a right to the city formalized in Lisbon that attends issues more or less to do with public space, for example, and now because of housing. But for me, what is questioning and interesting in Lisbon, but thinking Lisbon as a greater metropolitan area, is that you have a lot of movements which are not qualified as right to the city or not even qualify as a movement, but are daily basis practices of resistance and to search for a new common, a new way to do things. And that happens mostly in the periphery of Greater Lisbon, on the 5/6 of the population live. But all these movements are really unknown, and basically what is known is what's going on in the center of the city.
The right to the city is a right that this has not been developed so long in Portugal, if you think about it. It's like something far away, and usually individual groups, each of them wants to occupy a part of the city in a sense, and not in a collective way. And I believe also the way that we plan our city is usually in an individual way. And I believe that more and more it has to be in a collective way, that we all sit in the same table discussing what it should be the city. Migrants as well, but also women as well in their own perspective.
Right to the city, in fact, it's a very abstract slogan. In fact, it's being appropriated by politicians in their campaigns. So it's very hard even for an academic or an activist to explain what right to the city is. But I would say that it's a kind of full and total right for you as a citizen to appropriate and use the public space of the city, you know, with some duties, but also with rights of use. And of course, the appropriation of the right to the city is very difficult, is very different from group to group. We can say that it's difficult for an immigrant or an elderly or even a child to totally appropriate the city as he wants.
Igualdade de género e a luta pela igualdade de género nas cidades são assuntos fundamentais para se discutir e para se trabalhar quando se pensa cidade, porque o que ainda temos são cidades feitas, pensadas, construídas a partir do suposto neutro, e a figura do neutro é uma figura, no caso português, europeu, diria, e não só, o suposto neutro, a figura, o personagem, o cidadão neutro com que se trabalha e se desenha a cidade é o homem classe média branco, não é? Com mobilidade total, e neste sentido, é fundamental que outras perspectivas, que outros olhares, que outras reflexões e outras vozes cheguem à discussão e ao fazer da cidade.
For some years, people are blaming tourism, the touristification of the city center, and the deviation of some apartments from residential use to tourist use as the main cause of all this problem in the local housing market. But the problem is more deep. In fact, we have, since the beginning of the century, we have a bunch of laws that came that explain like a kind of neoliberal turn in urban policy.
For example, there's been, where we are now, there's been housing problems in this periphery since ever. But just now that gentrification get in the center of the city and is a menace to the middle class, you see the housing thing and the housing movements being, you know, in the front pages, in the discussion, while in fact it's been an issue a long time ago in a major city.
The gentrification in the cities is a problem that migrants themselves are facing in a daily basis, in the sense that they, most of them, occupy the center of the city. And when we talk about this, we are talking about the center of Lisboa, mainly. And this means that more and more the rents, when they came about 5 or 4 years ago, they could afford the rents, and now they are inviting them to go away. Sometimes with no money whatsoever for compensation, what we could say, and day by day they go to the suburbs.
Eu diria que se estás em condições de desfavor, de opressão múltipla, se mais uma vez tens, nesta visão interseccional, condições múltiplas de não privilégio, é óbvio que a gentrificação te atingirá de uma maneira mais violenta.
The problem is, and it has to do with history also, because the center of Lisbon exists for hundreds of years. So all the decision making in terms of cultural, institutional, academic, political are done in the center of Lisbon, which is a historical city where a lot of imaginary is produced because of being a capital, former empire, etc. And the periphery, as I mentioned before, is much bigger than the city itself, only exists for 50 years with this size, and it was done mainly by immigrant movements, and a lot of them also from Africa, from former colonies. So what I say is that, as an example, I do it as an example, and I use music and culture as that example to show people how our policies and our mainstream is detached from real life in a bigger city.
There are a lot of communities that are part of the city that you don't see. I gave the example of women that work in cleaning service in the morning. They come from 6 to 9 o'clock. Usually they go out before they open the door. And usually they come back after the door is closed. So you don't see them in the city, unless you go at 5 o'clock in the morning in the bus, and then you will see them.
Mas parece-me também fundamental sublinhar que as cidades, a relação das cidades com as mulheres não é só uma questão estrita da segurança. É fundamental pensarmos que a segurança, ou a percepção da segurança, é um resultado de outras coisas. Né? Se não tens acesso às atividades de lazer, às atividades de educação, às atividades culturais, à saúde, à mobilidade, aí a percepção é menor.
I will give an example for what we say on a suburb that was been a struggle, and at the moment is like sleeping. For example, Cova do Amor is a self-made neighborhood, because it was construction by the own migrants themselves in a moment that there was no housing policy so strong, and there was this idea of taking everything down and start all over again. And when the migrants themselves, all the people that made their own houses, in a collective way, they stopped this idea from a politician way. So this is also some movements that comes along, especially with migrants and also with people that live in this, in these areas. And I believe in Lisboa it's happened the same situation.
In the 90s, there was this huge rehouse program that was in fact to take people out of the shanty towns. And that was a widely support of that, for sure, because people who live in shacks don't usually have access to sewers and good conditions, environment conditions. But then when you look, in fact, what happened, they were rehoused, not in the case of the city of Lisbon, but in the cities around, really far away from where they were, because where they were in the 90s were already central places. So that was a process of gentrification. You take poor people from central areas, you put them in rehousing far away in rural areas that were really cheap, the terrain, and those central places now are real estate and are highways, you know. And nobody called that gentrification, and nobody worried about them, or because a lot of them were immigrants, they say, no, they're at the housing now, what they are complaining, right?
Also the work that I do is from African descent that was born in Portuguese soil, and that was born, live, and was raised here, that doesn't have the full citizenship. What we say is that means that they are, although they were born here, they were raised here, they don't have the same rights, for example, the right to vote, the right to circulate among what we call European countries. That means that they don't have the citizenship of this country. They are not considered Portuguese, but are considered coming from a country that most of them has never been.
As redes e as estratégias internacionais de conhecimento, troca e partilha de experiências são fundamentais. Eu, por exemplo, já venho de algum tempo esta parte a trabalhar com companheiras catalãs, por exemplo, mas também italianas. E esta Europa do Sul eu acho que é uma Europa interessante de se trabalhar, porque temos muitas pontes para desenvolver.
And the major problem is the same, which is we have a neoliberalism that produces space and produces space in a way to exclude. So of course, it's good for us to be in contact with each other. But as you mentioned in your question, a lot of those cities are already peripheral. So if we talk about Lisbon, about Athens, about Madrid, Rome maybe, they're not in the center of Europe, and they are usually cities where people don't have too much resources. And they are far away from each other. So imagine if I want to contact with Athens. We are both peripheral. We don't have money to travel, even middle class, for example. So it means it's really difficult for us to settle a network. Of course, that exists. There have been a lot of encounters between us, but it's rare and it's really difficult to be in contact because the precarious conditions produce a precarious network also. So it's difficult.
Morar em Lisboa, especially, has an international connection with a network which is called the Southern European Cities Against Touristification. It's the SET network. It's an important network that connects several cities from Southern Europe, like Veneza, Madrid, Barcelona, Marseille, but all these cities. A lot of cities, in fact, more than a dozen, they come together to try to unify their collectivities, especially against the impact of touristification in general quality of life of the inhabitants of the city.
O caso da América do Sul me parece fundamental. As companheiras argentinas, as companheiras brasileiras são inspiração e são fundamentais para a nossa aprendizagem.
We also have ABITA, which is a collectivity, and they are working in the international coalition for the right to housing. We had a seminar just a few months ago, and these seminars, these workshops of international networks are very important in all this connection because make us learn of what can we do better to change the situation.
It's important to make connection because we believe that my problem is not only my problem, it's a collective problem and it has to be solved in a collective way. Connecting internationally means that you can understand what other people are doing as well, but also they can understand what we are doing. So that together maybe it's not the same that we are doing, but it can go one step ahead.
Lisboa, cidade onde vivo, na pressa constante de sobreviver, que habito, percorri a cabo, sem chegar a conhecer. São casas, pessoas e rua, um mendigasmo lá num portal, e uma bica tomada a correr antes de ir trabalhar.